Welcome to the lecture number 27 for the peer-to-peer MOOC series. In this lecture, I will be talking about peer-to-peer search mechanisms, how we can create them. So this is like implementing your own Google. So Google is a search engine where actually you put in some keyword and you will get to know which all websites are related to that particular keyword. So in any search engine, typically the way it happens is it consists of three components. So there will be a crawler. So this is a special kind of server with a special software which goes to a website, and then it knows at least few documents, goes to that document, and that document will have hyperlinks to a lot of other web pages all across the sites. It will parse through the page, find out the other links, and it, with that page actually then it will figure out what all keywords are present in that. Okay, and then it will create a index entry for that, and it will say, okay, this for this keyword, this is the document URI. URI is universal resource identifier, which actually means what kind of transport, HTTP or HTTPS or FTP or telnet, any kind of protocol can be put, colon, and then of course the domain name of the machine where it was found and the directory structure with respect to the root of their web space. Okay, so that will be documented, that will be kept in a database, and we call it an inverted index actually. So this crawler will go there, and from that page it may go to another page, then to another page. So it will keep on just roaming around to the pages on the internet and keep on updating the inverted index which is being maintained. Okay, so we assume that inverter will now have not only hyperlink text document for which it is going to create index, it can also have PDF, it can have audio, it can have video files. So now crawlers are being built which can actually scan through PDFs, which can scan through audio, they can scan through video files, they can do image search. So indexing of any kind of content they should be capable of doing, but they just keep on roaming around one place to another and keep on creating the index. Okay, so that's how the search engine normally works. So these three components are crawler, inverted index, and the internet with web servers. Now normally crawler will put all found instances of a keyword. So normally every crawler will have a keyword which is it is indexing, and it will say this document is there, and so document will is linked to these particular document, it is referring to them, and those documents are referring to some other document and so on. Okay, and then when you will search for it, now remember a document which is created later in time will always be referring to a document which are created backward in time. The document which is in past cannot refer to a document in future. Normally you pick up a latest, whenever new documents are added, they have to essentially have to be searched for the existing keywords, and their entries have to be created, and from there then we have to find out the backward references and then check any new document which this any new document which is identified by this, the current one which I am actually crawling through, then those are updated, otherwise mostly it will be older documents. Okay, and so if you do this, these documents will form a hyperlinked or a directed graph will be formed, and this direction will be always from present to past mostly, unless you change the older document later and add a reference to the current document. Okay, so these hyperlinked contents will form a directed graph. So crawler will simply pass through this directed graph, keep on moving around, keep on moving around. So it may not be searching through the whole tree. So a document can, for example, be linking to say 10 other documents, and each one of those 10 are further linked to 10 documents. So as the depth of the search happens in that tree, what will happen is your, if the depth is D, 100 discovered D, those many documents will be there in the lowest layer. The crawler will be overwhelmed with that. So normally they just keep on doing randomly, and they are trying to maximize the probability of finding out some new information which can be put into the index. So crawler technically is crawling through this graph which is Ping is a representation of a distributed documents which are linked to each other. Okay, Google, Yahoo, etc. All these actually does this crawling business, and they create their own index. So when you go to a Google website and you put your keyword, this actually takes the keyword and searches through the inverted index. We call it inverted index because based on document I am not creating the entries, but I am based on the keywords I am creating the entries. So if a keyword is also repeating multiple times in document, I will also find out the location of that document where that keyword is being appearing. So it's a keyword based search, and this has to be done through crawler only. Okay, so forward index is when you create which is not inverted one, which is when in the beginning of the book when you create an index, that's a forward index. The in the back of the book what you create is an inverted index. Okay, so it basically now will look into the inverted index will with from your keyword and will give you a list of URLs to access the document. So this, which actually implies Google does not, or crawler does not store all the documents. It actually cannot, it requires huge space. So what normally does is it only just updates the index, forgets the document, move on to the next one, and keep on doing it like this. Okay, and document copies are not stored, which actually is not true. People have archived the internet at various point of time. You can go back and even see the deleted pages. That is feasible, but this unendingly actually puts a lot of pressure on storage. So far that is available, people will keep on doing it. At some point of time we have to start forgetting the past also. Okay, so normally we need to verify the authenticity of a document also which you are getting from a URI. So Google, why it is not keeping a copy? If it keeps and you get it from Google, you say Google has given you the copy, how do you verify the ownership of that document, authenticity of that document? It is always better to get it from the owner's server. That's why Google normally will not fetch it to you unless it's a cached form. We will actually have this challenge because we are going to do away with the servers in our case in peer-to-peer system. Okay, so that's the reason you actually search from inverted index, go to that user server and fetch it from there, and you know this is a user server, so you are having more faith on this. Okay, the news coming from Google servers directly is not probably authentic than the news coming directly from the newspaper server. Google and Yahoo also does something interesting, something more on this. It's not simply a search, and that's what actually essentially where the biases can come into picture. They look at on your how you are browsing and what you like, what you don't like. So whenever you search a keyword, they will now try to organize all the inverted index entries. They will filter it as per your liking, as per your profile. Okay, and of course they will also deciding on if somebody has paid for certain pages to be given at higher rank, so they will be always showing depending on the keyword that information also to you. For example, you search for say computer on a Google, and after some time you start getting advertisements at all other places, so it gives you a keyword search thing, but top two entries are technically advertisement. So that's how they make money. Okay, they have to make money to survive anyway. So displayed entries will get ordered in some fashion depending on how many people are using it, which is popular, and your own profile, and the advertising industry payments based on that. So page ranking is the one contribution which was there, and I think that what took off Google to what it is today. So because people like and their individual preferences are being accounted for in page ranking system. Pages are ranked accordingly. Now P2P search, when I want to do it, now I am technically now trying to replace Google, but now I am doing is I am the peer clients will be together will be doing this job. So I need to do now crawler and inverted index, these two need to be implemented. So there are no servers, they need to be implemented using some peer-to-peer mechanism. Of course the search space can still be the same internet. So I can have keyword and URI. URI can still be same HTTP colon something. So this idea was actually kind of has already been thought about, and Yaki.net is one such system which is available. You can download and install it. So your peer clients together do crawling and formation of inverted index, and they only give you the URL of a server on the web from which you can fetch the document. They don't actually again store any of the document. So that's a one type one kind of peer-to-peer search mechanism. So crawler and inverted index in peer-to-peer system, but what you are searching is in the overall web space, which is already existing, pre-existing one. There is another type which we can create where crawler and inverted index are again implemented through peer-to-peer mechanism. So what we search for is our own document, the peer-to-peer web, which has been talked about in one of the earlier videos. So where actually any user can now create dfs:// something like that, and then of course, so it will be now searching in that space dfs:// whatever is user ID, okay, and then www. So every user now is now creating in this space their own web, peer-to-peer web. So we can actually search through this and then create the index of whatever has been published by people. Now good thing about this peer-to-peer web is it is still authentic because it is now digitally signed by users. Instead of domain name, now the user ID or their email ID will be where the system will be rooted. The web space will be rooted now for every user, and we create an index for that. Now this cannot be crawled by, is not crawled by currently by Google or somebody else. So this need to be done. Okay, and even if the user is off, you can still get the answers or documents which are verified document, and indexes are going to be maintained in the same way. Okay, so it's like a same creating a DHT layer of inverted index, and whenever you find a document for a keyword mapping, you just publish it like a DHT publish. It will goes to the corresponding root of hash of the keyword and copy one, and there the URI and this mapping will be stored in the database, and copy two will automatically will get created from there. There will be always two copies maintained for resilience purpose again. And third possibility is that we don't actually use DHT. You are a node, you have some document, you want to make it available to public, but only you are storing it. It's not in your DFS web, it's on locally on your document space, and you can actually now have also your own local crawler. So you only want to know what kind of index entries you need to crawl for. So your crawler will only be looking, crawling into your own space and creating your own local index. Now how the queries will reach you? You are not a, there is no DHT mechanism here. So in this case, we will be going for an unstructured search mechanism. Now coming to the index keywords, how those will be handled. So there will be always unused keywords. So some keyword has not been used for maybe say many years, 5 years or 6 years. What should be done? Should I still maintain the inverted index? Probably no. So any unused keyword should be purged if they are not used for certain, for more than a certain period. And there is a possibility of having even new keywords actually. Okay. If there is a new keyword, there is no entry in the, your inverted indexes. You won't be able to give any result. But then crawler can now learn this keyword and start crawling with this keyword also. Okay, and then start essentially populating the inverted index for this. And similarly, the crawling rate for different keywords can also be modified depending on the usage frequency of various keywords. So that can be an additional thing. So Google, Yahoo and everybody also must be doing the similar thing. So any keyword will, any index database will normally will have a keyword and the list of URIs which can be, which need to be referenced from the, for this keyword actually. And it will also then have an expiry time of this keyword and last access time. So I think every server, every DHT, every node in the DHT will keep on looking into this and will keep on monitoring if the current date time and last search date time, the gap between them is more than the expiry period. Entry should be purged to create this space actually for more inverted index entries. So that's what everybody will be doing. And if keyword does not exist, there is no index entry, you just simply add to the list and crawler will start searching for it. Okay. So with mechanism 1 and 2, where basically the search space is the whole world wide web or your DFS thing, we can actually use a structured system, structured DHT for storing the index entries. Okay. And basically DHT, structured peer-to-peer network means a DHT based system is peer structured peer-to-peer. So user for example searches for keyword XYZ. So So you will just compute the hash of xyz underscore copy one and send it to the root node of that. So it will, the query will keep on moving around and into the DHT network, and it will go to the root node which is responsible. Okay, and this root node is also responsible for doing the crawling for this keyword. So crawling is also now being distributed. Of course, if it does not have capacity, it can always ask somebody else to crawl on its behalf and then publish the entries back to it. And this can also have a mechanism whereby it can start publishing this to, if it cannot have a storage space, we can use similar mechanism as we did in storage DHT layer, so that the entries can be distributed across everybody and people are not burdened with this. So this implies that different nodes will be responsible to crawl for different keywords, and you can use a spillover technique as used in storage DHT for the shortage of space to be handled. Of course, we don't require a reputation in this case because there is nobody's thing. It's a collaborative thing. So it's mostly will be philanthropy. Okay. If people don't want to contribute, it's going to be very limited in that sense. But yeah, corporations can actually put their own servers as a DHT and then can provide this space for doing this. Internally, my guess is that most of the search engine companies are also internally for their servers, they are creating very similar systems. And of course, if a node also does not have its capacity to crawl, it can ask other nodes to do it on its behalf as mentioned. And mechanism two, the crawling will be done in our DFS space. The URI will be of DFS:// user ID/something/something of that form. So those will also get included, which are not there in mechanism one. So Yaki.net only provides for mechanism one. Okay. One should try actually installing it. It's available on Snap Store of Ubuntu. So if you have a Ubuntu machine, you can download and you can directly install it from Snap Store and run it. Yaki-search, that's a command by which you start the command line. Then you can start browsing. You are not doing it on Google, so the advertising biases are not going to be there in this case. So normally the way it is going to happen is whenever you are going to search, a source will be sending a keyword. So what it will be doing, it will be sending a keyword via DHT route. So it will go to a root one, which is root of hash of keyword copy one. So this particular root node will also be publishing a backup copy, which is a root for hash of keyword copy two. So they will be essentially doing resilience mechanism by monitoring each other and republishing periodically. So whenever the query reaches it, it will directly send the keyword and value to the source. The source will be telling maybe its endpoint address or DHT node ID. So in both cases, it may take a different route, not the route through which the query arrived. So the root node also now should send the node from which it received the query to that also the keyword and value, so that it that can be cached there. So this is what we call a smearing phenomena. You smear the root entries which are being stored at a node around to the neighboring node, typically when the people are, a lot of people are trying to access the same keyword key value pairs. So the more a keyword key value pairs are actually being accessed, the more smeared they are around their node who is responsible for it. So this will actually avoid the loading of root node and makes the system far more efficient. For mechanism three, where there is no structured system which is required, because now you are actually trying to search through the content which are stored by the nodes at itself. Actually, they are not giving it into a DHT or in a DFS. Now, one thing which is important to be noted, that if a key value pair exists, you will always find it if it is going to be mechanism 1 and 2. Okay. But in mechanism 3, there is no guarantee that you will get the key value pair if it is existing. Okay, if it is, it is with high probability you will get it depending on how far your query actually gets propagated. Now, since it's a structured, unstructured thing, so there is no DHT routing. You do a broadcast routing in that case. So you know all the neighbors in your routing table, in your neighbor table, which has been created, as we had discussed in the earlier videos when doing routing. The source will simply create a broadcast query. It will put its own source node ID. It will say sequence number. Every sequence number has to be incremented whenever it initiates a query. And the age after which the entry can be purged from the broadcast table. This is being broadcasted to everybody. A query message is going to be attached. A time to leave field is also going to be added. So it goes to everybody, all of my neighbors. They will send to all of their neighbors. At any point of time, for example, see here, this guy has sent a query to these neighbors. They also send it to each other because they were connected. But then here the broadcast table will say this sequence number from this source I have already been received. So I am discarding it. So they both will discard. So everybody will only broadcast it, only the first copy, not the second, third and other copies actually. So this will keep on spreading like a tree to in the surrounding of source S. Okay, and everybody will receive the broadcast query. And everybody is now maintaining an index of the locally stored document. So they have to essentially receive a query, they have to search in the local documents. And if they actually have some documents, they will send the reference to that document back. They need not send the document itself. So as we later on will go through all the key value pairs, and based on that may ask you directly to fetch the document actually. Okay, so that's normally should be the procedure. Now when you are doing broadcasting, the age field is important. So if the age expires of an entry in the broadcast routing table, that entry gets purged. This is typically required so that if S goes off and then comes back again, it will start using a zero sequence number from zero. It does not remember the earlier sequence numbers. So then normally its queries will be disregarded or will simply be dropped because the sequence number which is there with the neighbors is higher. So once they are purged because of this age, then this source can start making the queries again. Normally this happens pretty fast, so it should not be an issue. So now typically the way it is going to happen, the query comes to node A. Node A will search, it will actually send the response back to S, but it will also send a response back to the node from which it received the query. So it will be kept in the cache. Okay, so this is basically next time if he does it. So idea is if S is searching, somebody in the neighbor of S may also search for it. Okay, locality of the query essentially that. So in that case, it will be satisfied from here itself. The response goes back and they can then talk to A and get the feedback actually, get the document. Okay. And if S gets a document, it can also keep a copy, but authenticity of A cannot be ascertained unless its document is digitally signed. And then of course, A will also send the query, will be forwarded to B, and a TTL value, time to live value, will also be reduced. So B can also again search the document in the same fashion and respond back. Okay. Now this entry which you are sending back can go via again DHT routing or IP routing. That's the way it has been told. So, and if a query is going to be processed much faster, that query will become more smeared, so it become much more easily available in case node dies off in that case scenario. Okay, of course the content will not be there, but content also can be cached actually. We can even have a provision where this same content get replicated to the cache also. So this guy can tell that I have a content and let content be digitally signed. So authentication is anyway taken care of in that case. And cached entries need to be purged after a timer expiry to keep the usage of space optimal. So now whenever a query will come, you will also search the local cache as well as your local database and send all the matching entry to the S. And if any entry which is being matched, those also will be sent to the previous node for caching purpose. Okay. So there can be multi-level caching which can happen if the entry is being requested again and again. And of course, now it can happen is that when at some place TTL can become zero. So if the TTL becomes zero, then the node will no more forward. So this entry will not be going any further. This will be simply dropped here. So as a consequence, query will only propagate it to this particular range. But edge node can do something more here. They can send the information that I was the edge node where TTL became zero. And this is my node ID or my IP address, port number. Basically direct endpoint address or node ID, both can be, either of them can be given. So S will get all the responses from within this zone decided by the TTL. Now it says I am not happy. Okay, and of course now another important thing, when a node makes a query, it will keep on getting the answers one after another for some time, and after some time it will stop getting the answers actually. So it may decide, okay, I am not happy with the search, I want to do much more of them. So it can actually now communicate to edge node directly and say, kindly you initiate a query on my behalf. It's a tunneled query to edge node, and it can keep the same sequence number which was done earlier, through which it figured out the edge node. Okay, so what will happen is the query will go to edge node, it will start the query again, but now TTL will be full actually when it is starting. So when the query will start moving backward, they will be discarded. Their broadcast routing table already have that sequence number, so it can only propagate outward, radially outward with respect to the source. Okay, so in the first, and when the TTL will go zero again, this will get stopped. So you will have a scenario where the source broadcasts, it goes out, there is a node, you tell him, it starts broadcasting. It is probably will can tell to many edge nodes, maybe all of them, and they will broadcast. So they will actually, now your region of influence will become this. You will start getting queries from here, and next time the edge nodes from here will be informed to you. The number of edge nodes which you will be getting will become larger and larger. Okay, so next time you can tunnel here, and this, all these guys will doing it, you again region of influence will become larger. So this is the same one TTL value. This will be another TTL value actually which you will get roughly. This will be another TTL value which you will get. So you can actually keep on increasing your searching space one after another. That is possible. But normally this will not be required, because routing table, the nodal degree which is there is pretty high. So normally if you look at a node will have large number of nodes as the children, not okay, so it will be 1, 2. So in fact for us we are using 160 nodes, we are using 120 actually neighbors which are going to be there. So query will essentially propagate very fast within a very few levels. So this tree is because of logarithmic partition. This is in addition to your neighbor tables. So ultimately I will be able to reach to almost all nodes in very small number of hops. So with a TTL of even 128 or something, you will be able to cover up the whole network, and all queries will be resolved. So this is how you can actually build up a peer-to-peer search engine. And next we will look into the anonymous peer-to-peer systems. So which basically means a talk chat, and then concept of blockchain. Now the blockchain is actually using the similar peer-to-peer network, and then we'll move on to the Tor network, which is the complete anonymity. Because in fact TalkChat as well as blockchain does not provide you anonymity in that sense. If you can monitor, find out the IP address, you can locate the guy. So even if you don't know their email ID or phone number, you can pinpoint the person or a building at least, so that information can be derived. We can also do traffic profiling to know if who is active and who is not active. So sometimes that is also not desirable. Okay, so that's basically talk. When we are going to talk about your Tor, that's basically also constitute something what we call darknet. It can provide mechanisms by which devices or services can, or the components can talk to each other while being remaining anonymous to everybody in the world. So people can't figure out, you can't do traffic profiling. We will move to that in the next video.